This is Whitley Strieber, and this is Dreamland. You've reached the edge of the world. Today on Dreamland, we have a guest who has been with us before and is an extraordinary guest. She is an expert on many, many different things. She did her PhD at the University of Missouri, her postdoctoral research at Cornell. She has been an academic in most of her life. She worked for the Defense Intelligence Agency and the Aerospace Center in satellite photography. She has worked at the Battelle Memorial Institute and has been an astronomer at the Ohio State University Radio Observatory. And with that kind of a background, you would think, is this going to be something about intelligence work? And you would not be entirely wrong, but not entirely right. We are going to be talking to Dr. Irena Scott
McCammon.
We're going to be talking to Dr. Irena McCammon Scott, Aliens and the Apocalypse. Irena, welcome back to Dreamland.
Well, thank you. I'm very honored to be here, as I said before, and thank you very much for having me.
Well, Aliens and the Apocalypse is a departure. You are, and yet not at the same time. It is. Let me do this. I want you to give us an idea about why you wrote this book, and then I'm going to get into some deeper questions, and I've got quite a few. Now, I guess the best start is, why did you write, what inspired you to write about potential end times and its connection to ancient prophecies and modern phenomena? Because that's essentially where we are here.
Well, one thing is the book I wrote with Philip Mantle about Beyond Reasonable Doubt about the Pascagoula incident. And that happened in 1973, which is about 50 years ago. At that time, there was a lot of turmoil, such as government scandals, such as Watergate and impeachment of the president and the possibility of nuclear war. And they actually had a DEFCON 3 alert, which has only been done twice, and the other one was a Cuban Missile Crisis. And so things sort of died down. Nobody was talking about nuclear war, or there weren't any wars going on. There were a big war in 1973, the Yom Kippur War with Israel, and that was what led to the nuclear alert. Well, now 50 years later, suddenly there's another war with Israel. There's impeachments, two impeachments. There's a big scandal and other things such as January 6th. And wars in Europe, and the possibility of nuclear war again. And so things have sort of died down for 50 years and started up again. And that had one thing to do with it. I was just saying that the times don't go away, they sort of come back. And the other thing is that in general, the way we solve our problems may be making our problems worse. And we sort of got over that for a while, but it may be coming back. And people are actually talking about nuclear annihilation, that sort of thing now. So that, in general, is why I wrote it. Part of my inspiration.
Okay, so you're looking at this era that we are in. It has a very climactic feel to it in a lot of ways. The human population has grown very large, maybe larger than the planet can sustain. We have the appearance of these, of what I call the visitors, these strange manifestations that appear to be aliens from another world on the one hand, but when you look at it closely, it gets much stranger. And now you're looking and very much at a strongly feminist view of the origins of life and we look upon evolution as it's very masculine, very Darwinian. It's a winner take all, fight to the death, may the best man win approach. But that's not what you say actually goes on in the past, is it? Not at all.
No, I was trying to present it as not saying it's feminist, it's saying this is a logical view based on the evidence. And today, we've always had predictions of the end ever since, you know, way, way back. And we've always attributed this to external things like a meteor hitting or a volcano or a plague or disease or something. But one thing that's happened recently is that we can destroy ourselves. And this is a big problem, maybe a bigger problem than anything else we can solve. And so that's why I was tying that to the end times.
But you know, another thing that I found fascinating is this sentence. There might be many reasons why aliens may appear as female. And I hadn't thought of that, but of course, if you look at the literature, mostly people experience female beings. I certainly did. I was kind of overwhelmed by the power, the feminine power of the being I first encountered and in my experience in 1985. And tell us a little bit about why it may be that these encounters have this feminine quality to it of an extremely powerful feminine presence that's in control and has perhaps non-feminine but also ambiguous helpers and servants. Like, I would say that my impression of what happened to me was there was one female in control, a number of other feminine beings that were sort of independent, and then a group of kind of drone-like beings, but there were no men, none. And I looked through the literature, like in the communion letters, and it's almost no one says that they are encountering males. Why is this?
I don't know. One thing, well, I mean, in my book, I answer the reason why is because I think in evolution, nobody knows it and nobody expresses it, but the cooperation is much more important than competitive, do or die, that sort of thing. But I was also saying, so far as what people think the visitors are like, when we go to other planets, we have big men with spacesuits and gas masks and the whole thing. And when one of our societies takes over one that's less developed, well, they have conquistador things where they go out and spear and kill and everything else and take gold and whatever. And so we have a natural fear of we may be taken over by other beings. And so if they're like us, we expect weapons, but and big males, you know, spacesuits and everything. But that's not what we generally see. I mean, I'm not saying we know what they look like. I'm just saying that the appearance in our art and our media is of females. And for instance, the whole idea of UFOs as vehicles with pilots, alien pilots and all that sort of came in with Roswell. And if you look at the sculptures of bodies of aliens at Roswell, which I had pictures of, they look female. But a lot of the other alien images, such as the grays and the ones in Close Encounter of the First Kind or whatever, Third Kind, look females. They're female size. They're not wearing gas masks or anything like we would. they're not wearing clothes, which, you know, protect us. And also we use for identity. They're oftentimes not wearing clothes at all. They're skinny little things with big heads. And they don't look like, you know, we would picture in our type of a society as powerful beings that come in and take over physically. They're more like little skinny women or kids.
One of the things you say in the book is that the goddess is much older than any of the male gods. Her religion came from the tradition of a peaceful creator. What happened here? Because it's very clear from the archaeological record that this planet, the very earliest civilizations were goddess-centered. Now they're not. We're very much patriarchal and God-centered and very warlike. And I'm wondering, was there something, some kind of an intervention here that changed the picture? What happened, do you think?
Well, I think in general, women started such a strong society that the men could take over, but I don't know if that's permanent or something that can cause trouble. What I was saying was scientifically, and I've done research and papers on the way mammals develop socially. And people have the opinion that groups of animals, I mean, if they have a group of females and a male in the group, well, this is a male harem, and the male put them together and, you know, controls them and everything else. And that's a general opinion from the from books by authors which wrote about the killer ape and how men came down from the trees and then picked up rocks and started killing everything, and that's what created us, was this killer ape and all that. Many books have been written about that, and it's spread widely in the media that that's how it, we developed, and that's what made it us successful. But it's not based on very much evidence at all. The evidence basically is they found bones of people and animals together, and so the people concluded, the writers and things, that therefore this is because the people killed the animals, and that's how we overcame everything and made us great. Well, it doesn't exactly agree with the evidence that they have, because if you look in our art, and humans go back to about 200,000 years, and 200,000 years, the art shows females. And during most of the time humans have been on Earth, they've shown females. I mean, like the very first art they found was a statue of a female that somebody carved. And most of the art from then on until maybe about 5,000 years ago was of females. And this is typical of the way mammals develop. They develop as not as male harems, but as groups of females that form the society. And like a lion pride, for example, is a group of female lions with grandmothers and great-grandmothers and offspring and everything else. And there's the male in the group is temporary. He'll be replaced shortly, and then another male comes in. They're not they're not a male harem. They're a group of females with female leaders, female permanent members, and everything else. And that's the way most animal societies are formed.
And it would appear to me to be the way the visitor society is formed, frankly. Because that fits my experience of them very well. And speaking of experience, free Dreamlanders, you're going to have a great experience right now.
Where is the unknown country? Is it out there in the stars? Or is it also somewhere else? Is it in us, in you? Unknown country, join us today. Go to unknowncountry.com right now and join us. Join the questions. Join the search. Join the adventure. Unknowncountry.com. There's no place like it in the world. Who are they? Why are they here? What do they want with us? Why is it all so secret? All of these questions are explored in my new book, Them, in an entirely new way. What do Close Encounter reports tell us about what the visitors want with us? What is the military's experience? And can our memories be trusted? Can anything be trusted? Them answers all of these questions in a totally new way. It's available in hardcover, softcover, as a Kindle, and as an audiobook, read by me. Get Them today, and you can get it from the unknowncountry.com store, signed by me.
We're talking to Dr. Irena McCammon Scott. Her website is irenascott.com. Her new book is Aliens and the Apocalypse. And I was just beginning, it seems to me that if I'm right in my experience and in the experiences of so many other people I have been involved with, the visitors have very much of a society that's like the society, the human society you're describing from the distant past. And I keep wondering why it changed and why it's different here, because I'm not so sure that the journey we have taken under the leadership of a male, in a male-dominated society, is ultimately going to work out for us. We seem to be in a pretty bad situation. And would we be in a better situation, a more stable situation, if that had not happened? And why did it happen? Irena, do you know?
Well, I think it's something that happens, would happen in animal societies too. I mean, nearly all animal societies are female groups that have males that come in temporarily and then are evicted by other males. I think what happened with our society is that females developed such a strong society. Well, in a normal animal society, though, the males don't take over because the females protect the young. In fact, I mean, many females will even sacrifice and kill themselves to protect the young. And this makes the next generation and helps it survive. If there's a lot of males, they're competing with the young and not protecting them. And that weakens the offspring. And so male dominance in an animal society wouldn't last very long because it wouldn't weaken them directly, but it'd weaken their offspring. But at this time, female humans have developed such a very strong society that they can take male dominance for now. But there's a whole lot of things that can go wrong with male dominance, and it's probably not why it's the standard in animal society.
Yeah, well, it can go wrong, because what happens when there's no balance is something tips, and we've tipped into a hyper-aggressive state of the planet. When I remember talking to Edgar Mitchell about his experience that led to his creation of the Institute for Noetic Sciences. And he said, I couldn't see any borders anywhere. I just saw the planet. And I felt that the planet was profoundly alone and bearing us, and that that relationship was what mattered the most. And yet, when I came home, I became an American again. And there's something there, because this division of mankind into all of these different peoples and places is diminishing us greatly. I mean, we've got all these languages. We've got, and it's wonderful. The cultural diversity is beautiful, but it's also a hindrance in some ways. I'd like to talk now. I'd like to shift. You've got a fascinating chapter on something me and my group of listeners are fascinated by, which is owls. We had Mike Cleland on recently on the show. And of course, he is the expert on this relationship. But you've got some very interesting things to say about the relationship between the close encounter experience and owls. And of course, as you point out, I did a lot of wrestling with owls, in my experience, because the first thing I remembered was seeing an owl in the house, which was impossible. That was the beginning of my whole life in this. Tell us what you think about owls and their relationship to the experience.
Well, I had a relationship with an owl too, but it wasn't like yours. When I was about 5 years old, we had real owls in the barn, and I was just fascinated by them. It was my uncle's barn, and was climbing around, and my relatives were out in the field, and they heard this crash in the barn. They wondered what was going on and came, and there my body was. I'd broken a hay rack and everything else and fallen through the barn somehow. They picked me up and carried me out, and I guess eventually I came too. But that was my experience with owls. But I was talking, your experience was a lot different. I was talking about owls as sort of like spiritual beings, and they've been in our literature for, in the art, I mean, way before we had literature, in the art for way, way back. And what today they have the idea of ancient aliens, that what we would call elves and fairies and things like that, back before anybody heard of UFOs, were often depicted as spiritual beings. And a lot of the art is of spiritual beings, probably, if you interpret the art. And a lot of that is with big eyes and things that look like owls. And there was the owl goddess, and there's been a book written about the owl goddess in quite a bit, but a lot of our ancient art is about owls. And it looks just like aliens today, and it looks like the cover of a famous book called Communion, where there's a being there with big eyes. And that symbol, I think, a lot of people saw your book cover and instantly bought the book and recognized it. But I think that symbol's been with us for a very, very long time. And it was called the Eye Goddess back before there was writing or anything, when there was just art. The Eye Goddess and the owl have been important symbols in humanity for a very long time.
Julian James, in his book, The Origin of Consciousness and the Breakdown of the Bicameral Mind, talks a lot about the eye goddess and the power of those eyes. And of course, I experienced that in the communion experience, because what I came away with was eyes that I could only relate to an owl. Now this, the eyes, they go back. I mean, the owl, it goes back so far. I mean, it goes back into the caves. And as you point out, it's possible that the owl, because owls walk on 2 feet and they fly, of course, too. And they have those faces that look faintly human in a very in a very dramatic way, that the people of the distant past may have thought of them as a different form of human being. And of course, if the visitors were here then too, they would have in a sense been right. Because, you know, my first few weeks of my remembering this experience, I couldn't differentiate between what had actually been there and an owl. It was very mixed up in my mind. I couldn't understand what had happened to me, in part because I couldn't understand how an owl could have done that. It was very confused, as you can imagine. But where did, do you think the visitors were here in the distant past and people in those days had the same kind of confusion?
Well, the owl in some ways, it's a lot different from a regular bird because in order to fly and avoid branches and not crash and everything, you need to see. Well, nearly all birds are out in the daytime. The owls are different because they're out at night and they fly through fields and through woods and things like that and avoid the obstacles. And when I see owls in the woods, I'm amazed because a lot of birds, big birds like that, fly up above, but owls will go right through the woods. Well, when I see them in the daytime, I suppose that's what they do at night too. And that's one thing that's different from birds, the rest of the birds. Another thing is, like you said, they look like people and they have big eyes like aliens, and yes, they on two legs. And they've actually put pictures of baby owls on the internet and said these are aliens because they're little things walking around looking like aliens. But
the owls are so strange looking. We have to take another break now. We'll be right back.
Have you ever read Communion? Or have you never read Communion? It's out in a new edition. Very powerful, a subtly new cover that reflects the fact that the visitors are now looking back at us because they truly are. You can get it from the unknowncountry.com store as a Kindle, as a beautiful, sumptuous paperback, or as an unabridged audiobook read by me. It's the first time in the whole life of Communion that it has been read in full in audio format. And believe you me, I felt that reading. I put my life, my memories into it, and I trust you can hear it in the voice. I sure felt it while I was reading. So get Communion, listen to it, read it. Communion is of central importance to all of our lives.
This is a brief excerpt from an interview with two contactees who had an 11-day close encounter experience and are now willing to speak about it, really, for the first time. To hear their whole interview and many others, subscribe to unknowncountry.com. Here's the excerpt. Did you see the man's face?
Yes. Actually, that one is very clear to me. It was kind of longish, and he didn't look completely human, but because he had very, very thin hair, almost non-existent, but he was young. I believe that it was kind of blonde. And he was very tall, like at least six feet. And he was so thin that he looked kind of strange.
And what happened then?
Well, he wanted me to go with him, or to stay with him. He wanted me to stay with him on the ship. And I'd been married for 6 months, and I wasn't about to go running off to stay on the ship.
Now, surely you want more. You must want more. And there is more. Not only this contactee interview, but many others, many of them just as extraordinary, on unknowncountry.com, plus everything else that we offer, my audiobooks, the meditations, the talks on the key, William Henry's wonderful revelation show and its entire run, and Strieber's brilliant and magical mysterious powers, and so much more. Hours and hours of listening pleasure. Learn from the meditations on the site. Really learn, because they're real and they're valuable. Subscribe to unknowncountry.com right now. Go to unknowncountry.com. Click on the subscribe tab. We are running very low on new subscribers now, and that should not be. It should not be happening. So you do it. You go there and you do it today.
We're talking to Dr. Irena McCammon Scott, Aliens and the Apocalypse, The Meaning of Alien Messages. And this message, the message of, that's a visual message, relating them to owls, is very important, because they, you know, the owl is a predator who can dig into a little burrow underground because his sensitive ears and her incredible strong claws, she can actually hear the little chipmunks and so forth running around in their burrows at night, and can go down and rip into the burrow and pull them out. Now, my burrow got ripped into and I got pulled out. That happened to me. And I'm not a chipmunk, I don't think. And that wasn't an owl that did it. But what do you make of the connection here? It's a symbolic connection, in a sense, a connection in nature. And it tells me that our visitors are in some sense a predator, like an owl. Can you riff on that at all?
Yeah. If you go back in history and look at cave paintings and drawings, a lot of times the interpreters today don't know whether they're owls or people, because of walking on two legs and the whole thing. And then also this image also is of the deity, whatever deity they had at that time. And so they're mixed up in way, way back too. And so you don't really know actually. Today we think we know everything with science, but we don't know what reality is. We just think in, as I mentioned in my book a number of times, we think in symbols, and this represents reality. Like, for example, you mentioned Julian James, and he was talking about our consciousness and the way we think. And the way we think is that if you picture yourself in a room reading a book, you don't really picture yourself there reading a book. What you picture is a bird's eye view of yourself. You picture yourself walking in the room, picking up the book and reading like you're somebody else. You're not yourself, you're external. And that's sort of the way we think in symbols. We can view ourselves from the outside. And this may have something to do with the owls and things, is pulling ourselves out of ourselves, like you said. I don't know about predators or not, because people are doing a pretty good job of killing all kinds of things, including ourselves. And so I wouldn't say an owl, I mean, they're a predator, but we do some pretty awful things too.
I think I wasn't going to discuss too much about the Pascagoula incident, but I do want to do that, actually, because you are one of the great experts on this extraordinary UFO case, and it's probably one of the best abduction cases ever recorded. I like to think mine is very convincing too, and others are as well. But this is a remarkable case, and what makes it so remarkable is that it happened in a much larger context. We concentrate just on the case itself, two men taken aboard a UFO and frightened out of their wits. But there was a much larger event. Can you take us back to 1973 and to what was happening in the world in terms of encounters at that time? And then we're going to talk about the alien in the UFO and exactly what this being was like. But first, let's build a picture, if you will, of the world then with its the tremendous explosion that occurred with all of the UFO activity, the upheavals in our society. It was 1973 was quite a time.
Yeah, that was approximately 50 years ago. And there were many things happening. The Pascagoula abduction made big news. And that was surprising because there were so many other things going on. For example, there was the impeachment and the scandal in Washington of the Nixon scandal and Watergate and all that. Also, there was the Yom Kippur War of Israel and the DEFCON 3 nuclear alert that nuclear war is impending. It may happen any time. And they had all these ties between different governments. One's attacked, the other one attacks and all that. So there was a real possibility of war. There was also a huge UFO wave. And now it's 50 years later. There was relative peace in between. Nobody was talking much about nuclear war. And suddenly now, which is about 50 years later, there's the same thing. There's presidential impeachments. There's scandals such as January 6th. There's war in Europe, which hasn't happened for a long time. The Ukraine war, and also there's a war in Israel. There's talk about nuclear weapons again, and it's like things repeated over 50 years. And another thing was that sound, and that was something I experienced myself. And so it's like things were peaceful and everybody thought everything was fine. And now the same problems are appearing that just like went through a cycle, and 50 years later, here we are in kind of the same situation.
Well, yeah, tell us about the sound, because the sound was it was huge. It was an extraordinary event. Tell us what you found out about that sound and when it occurred and so on and so forth.
Well, it first came to my attention because at that time, same time as the abduction, but I didn't know it then, my parents had called me. I was in Missouri and they were in Ohio, which was 600 miles away. And my mother called and said, "Did you hear that explosion?" And I told her she was crazy and joked about it because I couldn't hear anything from Ohio, 600 miles away. She called later, several days later, and said there was this huge UFO invasion type thing of people staying in, keeping their kids in, hiding in the basement and everything else. And one of her friends was chased by a UFO. She wasn't a believer or anything like that. She was a skeptic. So that was odd. So many years later, I decided to look up if I could find when that call came in. And I did find it. And it was the same time as the Pascagoula abduction, but I didn't pay attention to that. Instead, I was interested in the sound, and I started doing research. The state seismologist from Ohio contacted me and helped me find seismographs and things, and I wrote it up in the scientific literature as an unexplained sound. Well, then I published a book with Philip Mantle, and he started investigating the Pascagoula abduction, and it turned out the sound that my parents had called me about way, way back was happened same time as the abduction, which was interesting. And then he wanted me to interview witnesses. And so far as Pascagoula now, we have, it's probably the best documented of any abduction account ever. But also there was this sound and at the same time, and we called our book Beyond Reasonable Doubt, because there might be enough evidence to convince a jury that something happened with the abduction, but the sound might actually convince scientists that something unusual happened.
You said the last time you were on Dreamland that this might have been the loudest sound ever recorded.
I don't know if it was the loudest, but I think it was probably, it covered a huge area. It covered from, the actual audible sound that people heard, not just vibrations and things. It covered from Iowa it went past Washington, D.C. to the coast. And this was a real sound that people heard. It was widespread, and it was picked up by two seismographs, which is pretty unusual. I think it was the most widespread audible sound that was on record. But it was also, sounds such as they've studied sonic booms now. And if an airplane goes over and makes a sonic boom, they know how far the sonic boom will come from the airplane. And it depends on the height. So that if a low airplane makes a sonic boom, it makes a smaller one. If it's higher, it makes a larger one. Like if it's at 80,000 feet, it will make a sonic boom of about 80 miles or 40 on each side. Well, this was it was interpreted, first of all, as a sonic boom, but it was way, way, way larger than a sonic boom, because it may have been heard from New York into Tennessee. And its width, I kind of estimated its height, and that would be about 50 miles. And at 50 miles, you wouldn't hear anything because there's no air up there. So
yeah, that was just going to ask, what produced the sound? Do you know?
No, because it didn't go along with the laws of physics, because by the laws of physics, if you're up high enough to make that white a sound, you would be so high nobody'd hear it to start with. Well, this had
atmosphere to carry sound waves.
No, but this was such that people were reporting an immediate explosion, like my mother. And over a wide area of the country, it traveled from Iowa to the coast. And there was two seismographs, and I could calculate the speed, and it was approximately three times the speed of sound. But it was very wide, too. And at that distance, you wouldn't hear it. But instead, at that time, there were sonic booms from planes, but this just stood out because there were newspaper reports all the way across the country at different times saying everybody contacted the police and the fire departments and everything else, and the fire departments actually made runs, and people thought there was an immediate explosion right there. Yeah. It shattered windows in different places, things like that, which it obviously wouldn't do at that height. So it made no sense at all, so far as physical principles.
Well, you know, this was in, what year was this? In 1973, right?
Uh-huh. Yeah.
Now, was it heard in New York City?
It was heard in, it wasn't heard in New York City. That I got reports from, it was heard in, I think it was called Binghamton or something that I can't pronounce.
Yeah,
and
because I think it did hit New York City. I lived in New York City. What time was it?
It was 1973, October the 11th. And it was around 9 o'clock.
In the morning?
No, at night.
At night. You know, I have a vague memory of something like that. And, you know, the last time we talked, I thought I should have brought that up. And I'm bringing it up now, folks, because if you lived in New York City or anywhere around there in those days, in that time period, look back and see if you can remember it, because I wish Anne was still with me. She would have remembered it very clearly. She had a terrific memory for anything like that, anything unusual. She would file things away, and I have a tendency to blow things off, unfortunately. And but I would swear that there was something that happened that we thought was a sonic boom. We thought, well, that's what it was.
Yeah, registered on a seismograph there, but it also registered up in an Air Force base by the Finger Lakes. I mean, there was just a report of something happening then.
Well, it's an interesting question, because I think I might have heard it. Okay, I can't be absolutely sure.
If you have any data or anything on that, let me know.
Yeah, well, I don't know if I could find it, how I could find any, because it must. I do know that it wasn't earth shattering. In other words, it must have sounded enough like a sonic boom for me to be only vaguely aware of it. Because a sonic boom, of course, you don't hear sonic booms over New York City, but you can. I mean, I have heard some explosions or maybe a lightning strike or something. I don't really remember, but maybe we could find out. I mean, we could find out if it was, I could look in old newspapers and so forth and the newspaper archive and see if there are any reports of it. But the important thing is this. The sound was created by something we don't understand. And then there were UFO sightings all over the place. There was a huge UFO wave right at that same time, wasn't there?
Yeah, plus abductions and strange abductions. And
tell us a little bit more about the abductions. But, you know, actually, we've reached a sad point in the show. It's time for me to say goodbye to our free listeners and to move on down the road with our subscribers. So, free listeners, thank you so much, as always, for listening. As always, I urge you to subscribe. Now is the time.
You've been listening to Dreamland. Be sure to tune in again next week. Dreamland is brought to you by unknowncountry.com and its family of subscribers. Our theme music is The O of Pleasure by Ray Lynch. Unknown Country was founded by Ann Strieber. Our news editor is Matthew Frizzell. Our coordinator is Amy Safrankova. Whitley Strieber is your Dreamland host. And I'm your announcer, Ted Alexander.